it's academic and it's theater, the place where they both meet.
You have to be audience and participant for each other.
Intellectual practices, historical practices, cultural practices.
Everyone? Everybody, please.
Examples of women.
Sharing what it is that you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
Welcome all around the world. You can come and see and talk about.
What time is it now in Kenya?
Started out about different people and about different things.
A whole sea of phenomena.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's just what should be done.
Have to be completely open.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death
has already changed.
Welcome, everybody, to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY. My name is Frank Henschke, and I'm the Executive Director and Director of Programs here at the Segal Center together with Antje Oeger. So thank you for coming out on a Monday evening on a beautiful day where so much is going on, especially tomorrow, but we see a big connection between the both days. And so thank you, really, for coming. Tonight, we do celebrate the legacy of Judith Malina and Julian Beck with the Living Theater. And Judith Malina was a very good friend of the Segal Center, we are honored to say. Very often, actually, she came out from Englewood to join our evenings, Monday evenings like this, participated, talked, and said it was her home, in a way, in New York. She says, the only place I still go because it's complicated. And often Brad and others brought her here, drove her back, was a big effort. But we could not think of a higher compliment than this. I'm just calling my mother-in-law. I don't know what. I didn't know how this happened. I think the Living Theater and Judith really have occupied a very special place in New York theater history, American theater history, but also world theater history. And it does not always happen. It's something very, very rare. It's like a very great writer, a great novelist, a great musician, and great theater people, and what they did changed theater, the way we look at theater, the way we understand theater, teach theater, do theater, and everything changed with them. And we really wanted to do a tribute to her and celebrate her life and work together with Julian, but we wanted also to look a bit in the future. It's not really in that sense a memorial or celebration. We often, you know, then we would have asked many, many people also from over the decades who collaborated to speak, but it's to see what's happening now, where is it going to? So we showed all day films. We started at 10 o'clock from the very early, the connection, the Brig, just to the road trip the guys just did in October. So, just to celebrate that moment. And I think she might have been here with us if we had done a political theater evening around the election, which we were thinking about doing it, but we thought, why don't we celebrate the legacy of the Living Theater, which is so close connected to what political theater is, might be, should have been, or can be again. We will find out, like Greek theater always, in the beginning was a context, was giving, discussing things that was happening in the city. Social issues were kind of worked out through theater, and I think this is something the Living Theater kept on, that thousand-year-old tradition, and we are very honored to have them all here, and especially the company as of now. I would like to ask you to turn off your cell phone. If you can, I'll do the same. Make sure it is on off. The evening should not be longer than 90 minutes. And we will hear a piece that was written by Philip, who's a member of the company, where he collaged some material as an assemblage. And with it, and we would like to ask you all to then join us in a discussion after a short panel discussion with some of the artists present. Again, thank you. Brad also, as you might know, works with us here at the Segal Center, that we are honored to have him here, and I turn it over now. And Cindy, again, coming back, you were just with us last week, and everybody here in the audience, Marvin Carlson, Louis Fleck, and Sophie Proust from France, Joe Metallo, so many people, and many, many many others, Jean Louis. So thank you all for coming and for being here and to really think again and celebrate the life and work of that extraordinary company and that extraordinary woman. Thank you.
When I am dead, who will remember my grandmother's grave? Somewhere in Staten Island rests the remains of a Polish Jewess who settled in Kiel, in the north of Germany, too far from her native Krakow. Her daughter married a rabbinical student who went to America to found his congregation when she was old. And her husband, Solomon, rested in peace. She traveled to New York to live for a while with her daughter, Roselle, and Rabbi Malina, and Judith Malina. She died, still writing poems, in the home of the Daughters of Israel, where we visited her weekly in her final years. And now, as I near 50, I wonder, should I no longer consider the annual planting and save up for perpetual care?
Jody.
Malin. Yes.
Julian.
Pleasure. Go-Go says you're the most marvelous man I'll ever meet.
Well.
And all it cost me was a plate of spaghetti.
Pardon?
He asked me for some of my chocolate. I bought him dinner. And in return...
Me.
You.
I see what I'm worth.
But are you?
Am I?
The most amazing man I'll ever meet.
Well, I don't know about that, but I'm certainly worth a plate of spaghetti.
I should hope so. What do you do, Julian?
I'm a painter.
A painter?
Yes, and I write poetry, mainly.
I write, too.
Poetry?
Yes.
Are you a poet, or are you someone who writes poetry?
Well, I don't know if I'm anything at all yet. But I'm going to be an actress.
Why an actress?
Why anything? My mother always wanted to be an actress. That's part of it.
You're lucky my father wants me to be an automobile technician.
It's not ignoble to work with your hands.
And yet...
Yes. My father, Rabbi Max, helped Jews to escape Germany. So I know how bad it was. Early on, it was all we talked about. 1938, Hitler is going through Europe, taking small nations one by one. I am in bed in New York City, thinking about it. Suddenly, I'm overcome by claustrophobic horror. The very walls seem nearer and menacing. Burning near stifles me, and I say aloud, "It's too hot." Then the feeling passes. But that moment was the war for me.
People in little kitchens trying to turn around? Go away. You are a Jew. Maria Rosa turned around in her kitchen 150,000 times, a turbine fueling the family. Till it became a jewel of the empire, buried in the Italian mud, the mind filled with heavy wind, sulfurous fumes filled with particle of rubber, breathable but invisible, the debris of 100 million autos speeding on the highways. There's no cure for those particles when they get in the air. Got no rubber magnets, said Bookchin and Murray. The waiter looks at me.
My tears fall in the soup.
says Judith when I look at him.
And know that I can't tell him what means the great multi-hued revolution when he and I will be equally privileged. Not like same size stones, but not he as ripped porter, nor I as nipped woman.
Do you need anything? The waiter asks. Salt, perhaps? The tears fall into the soup.
No, it is already salty.
Going out on stage is always difficult. I used to think it was because there was terror of forgetting lines or stumbling. Humiliation, too simple an explanation. And I used to think that the terror the performer feels before going on stage was because the audience, sitting in the dark, was something fearsome. The anonymous brute. The king, who sends letters de cachet to those who displease him. The madman who slays without reason. The mob that throws rotten eggs and tomatoes. The firing squad. The black-robed man who sits in judgment on dais between brass, eagle, and flag. The shadow. Then I knew that the audience was a lover whom I feared to disappoint. Then the audience became the people I'm sure, to whom the performers returned with messages from outer space. And could they tell them that there is nothing there, or that they didn't get there, or that no one can? Then the hypothesis began to be tested. I began to act in things in which there were no lines to memorize. The lights went up in the house, and we met and talked with the audiences. The audiences became people, and then individuals, and we had dialogue with them. Then they came to throw eggs and tomatoes. In France, in the spring of 69, when Ritus gave us omelette finales and performances to express their disapproval of what we were doing and saying, and militant-minded leftists bombarded the stage with tomatoes and firecrackers to express their rage and disappointment with the fact that we, who bore the imprint of radical thought, who carried the black flag of anarchy, should carry the flag onto the stage of a bourgeois bastion. We who were saying to society, discard the structure, metamorphose, leave the cocoon, pull yourself out of it. We were there, still inside the theaters. The students were assaulting us with truth. We had to get out. Hard to do, but not so hard that it cannot be done. And what has to be done is hard, and I want to make it harder and harder. And the harder it is, the easier it is. It has to do with the releasing of energy.
But in 1982...
things were better. Progress.
Yes.
Poems of a wandering Jewess. There is time because we are mortal. There is death because we are nothing.
There is love because we are crazy and want to be happy forever. I remember when you wrote that.
And after... after you passed, long after you passed, we did a show, Korach.
From?
The Old Testament. The story of Korach.
The Old Testament.
Some say that Korach and his tribe were the first ever anarchists. And we did Korach in our own space, another living theater, our own space in New York.
With Hannon. I remember Hannon.
He was a wonderful man.
After I passed, did he?
We took care of each other. And we took care of the theater. He wrote a great number of great plays. And he remembered all of your recipes.
My recipes.
Towards the end, when things were bad after the diagnosis.
Stomach cancer, yes. I always had a feeling. If it wasn't the colitis, it was going to be something of the stomach. Always thinking about the stomach and about feeding the people. I ate an entire handkerchief bit by bit at the age of 6 at the Metropolitan Opera performance of Hansel and Gretel. My father thought I was eating because I was nervous, which was true, but I was also eating along with Hansel to identify with him. The tasteless, awful handkerchief, and then I didn't have to eat it anymore. All the children were free, out of the oven, uneaten, alive, and still to grow up. Everything I have ever done in the theater has been an attempt to free the yearning for freedom from the witch's prison cage, which the Hansel and Gretel experience gave me. Feed all the people, as important as stop all the killing. Always the stomach.
Yes, and after you were diagnosed, cancer of the stomach.
Heaven.
At the full moon in June, 1984, Julian was in the Medical Arts Hospital, gravely ill, where Allen Ginsberg visits him, is gloomy, and takes pictures, while Hannon calls everywhere to find a hopeful therapy.
And?
You taught him all my favorite recipes before you died.
So that he would be able to make them for you, yes.
I never...
Really learned to cook, right?
It was a form of protest.
Against
marriage!
Our marriage.
The institution that is marriage. Am I married? Is this my home? Is the child that I am expecting a real, living person to be? Are these strange, cool people now related to me? Is this my life that I am living? Is it for this that I prayed and hoped through all my childhood? For this emptiness? What of the dream? What of the woman that I was to be? Enough of these haunts. It's morning, and I should try to use the day. You were my soulmate from the moment we met until the moment you died. But to be married.
Of course.
And why have anything other than a revolutionary marriage?
Why have anything that is not revolutionary? Vast plans, small works. When do we get to the real work? The work of the revolution, which I write with a capital R because until it happens, there is no other.
I talk to everyone and ask what they think can be done. And everyone comes up against the same wall and draws a blank. A useful plan to which people can turn with hope, which will bring energy. I am convinced that that is the only valid work.
If you're going to have a cup of coffee...
Make it a revolutionary cup of coffee. Your participation in our marriage was a revolutionary experiment as well.
No doubt about it. I am dominated by the presence of the penis. I'm always thinking about some penis. I imagine how it appears. I imagine a slow-motion film of its expansion. I imagine them in many shapes, with all meticulously realistic, with errant flabs and protrusions. And I watch the bulges wherever I go, consider the relationship between form and content. I become myself by doing this. When I avert my eyes, caught at this practice by my censorious captain, I lose presence and pulse. All signs of life pale into the horizon. But when I give over, I become the hunger for entity, the repeal of identity, the yes and no substance of freedom. This is the nature of my sexual magnitude, love enslaved, Prometheus bound, phylocracy. I am dominated by the penis. More than by the sky, less than by hunger. 16 years old, homosexual intercourse with masochistic fantasy. I recognize sex outside of the limits prescribed by society, especially with boys and men, as revolutionary. The artist as one who experiments with his own life, trying to extend the limits of behavior.
The turn towards ecstasy as a form of depolarization for the discouraged.
You either consciously elect to be an element in the struggle, or you are manipulated by it and subjected to its vicissitudes, its victories and defeats, slime on the floor wreckage.
Our own life and our living theater as one long 70-year experiment.
Did we get closer?
To?
The beautiful, non-violent
anarchist revolution.
Did we?
Get closer to the revolution. There were moments when I felt like we would. When I really thought we would.
But?
Not yet.
Then we have work we must continue to do.
Yes.
Even the ruling classes are beginning to realize that contemporary society is not a solid crystal, but an organism capable of changing and continually undergoing change. If time is not brutal.
Time is not brutal.
How beautiful it all is, and how beautiful we all are in this terrible and beautiful film of becoming. How the experience of beauty validates pain. Compensation, masochism. On this planet, so many errors bound in the prisons of our societies and our ways. A man has to vault his way out. No one tells you how. You have to learn.
Learn patience first. After patience, love. And after love, the eternal joy of having loved. But after the revolution, everything will be poetry.
We can make excuses for history or say things have changed, but we can't dismiss all its lessons. We need a new form. There are better people than me to find it, but they are not doing the job, and it must be done. And if not I, who? And if not now, when? And if I am not for myself, who shall be for me? I follow anyone who makes the destination clear. But if no one does it, I will ask them to listen to me. And I will make it clear, or else I will expose the weakness of every ideology now going, will destroy the illusions and leave only what is real. Human, meaningful, practical, and beautiful. And to those who say it can't be done, I'll say bullshit and prove otherwise. What side are you on? I'm on the side of those who believe you when you say, one, stop all the killing. Two, feed all the people. 1 + 2 or 2 + 1. The Maoists have the second part right, but are very fucked up in part one. The pacifists are right on the first part, but don't know how to accomplish either part effectively. If you switch clauses, or the order of the clauses as you want to, my dear Carl, you don't really solve. You put off. And maybe that's the best you think you can do. But I'm on the side that can do better. Let's find a way to make it work. A comradely embrace and sisterly love. All power to the people, To arm is to harm. There are stronger forces than guns to make a new world. Find them. Love. Judith. The forsythia is brilliant yellow behind the house. A cherry red tree blossoms across the road. But Breck said, we live in an age when to speak of trees is almost a crime. Love.
Do you think we'll ever get there?
I have to believe we will.
Then we will. In Paradise Now, had we not brought the audience to the doors of the theater and said, the theater is in the space! And did we not stand there at the doors, face to face with the police who do not want life to reach and surpass the privileged position occupied by art, who do not want the streets to be free? It was there, at the doors of the theater, that we knew the street was the place we had to go.
The street, I thought, as the brighter light of freedom flooded my eyes, is the place that surrounds the prison. The people walking in the street lost the enchantment that they had when seen from behind the mesh screens and grating of the women's house of detention. Because while from inside, they seemed to be free, as soon as I stepped out, they were as I was. And I was not ever again to be free while prisons exist, and I am not free now. I am not free because I am in the street that surrounds and encircles the prison. The street that squeezes its misery into the prisons as if to rid itself of pain by compressing it into its innards. In the streets, on a farm, or at sea, or on the road, or in the metropolis. In the street is on that narrow strip around the walls that enclose the secret sins of the world and the elemental human, where we hide away our untamed part instead of letting our minds know how our hearts feel.
Free.
Unashamed and compassionate.
We are a feelingless people. If we could really feel, the pain would be so great that we would stop all the suffering. If we could feel that one person every 6 seconds dies of starvation, and this is happening, someone is dying from starvation, we would stop it. If we could really feel it in the bowels, the groin, the throat, in the breast, we would go to the streets and stop the war! Stop slavery! Stop the prisons! Stop the killings! Stop destruction! Take the cue. Go into the madhouse and find out the truth in the imbalance of order of things and the perversity of real love. In the bursting cysts of the mind, no more deception. If you want to see what's what, you have to be mad! Able to confront the horror!
Any play might be the play that starts the revolution.
Then we must continue putting on plays.
We must always continue. You spoke in energetic time. I knew this was the way routed for despair. But you had heard an ancient seagull cry
and drop its wetted wings and swerve and die.
You taught me how to listen to the clamor of superstition, bedazzling out of nothing all our fears. We monarchs could never be withstood. If I could comprehend that substance that is fire and fathom all the mystic dreams of priests and monks and nuns and fire worshippers, then your objective speech, coming unuttered, might find my mind a prey. This way is obviously routed to despair. Nevertheless, I love you. Life is not simple, but we must not let the complexity frighten us.
I tremble that all this might someday shatter and fade away. A delicate sphere within which I move, so pleasurably sustained, family, community, work, theater, enough to eat, the privilege of traveling from country to country as we play our plays. I ride in a VW bus and sometimes a hair out of the mane of the horse of temporal fame brushes a cheek. Outside the moving window and inside the moving brain, it's like too much good fortune. And all the time that we ride around in these buses, all these years, I live in dread that it might one day just fade away.
My grandfather was cutting bread.
We shall not meet again,
he said. I thought, why does he cut the bread that way? Laying it on a board as if it were a fish. Mama and Oma, when they cut the bread, hold it against their breasts. They cut firmly. It frightens me when the knife moves towards their bodies. Opa is sensible. To lay it on a board and saw at it like that. I said, what do you mean? We shall not meet again. I shall come back. I thought, on the ship, I shall walk through the dancers, careful not to brush against the gowns, because that's the rule of my game. And besides, the dancers get angry. He said,
even if you come back, I won't be here.
He looked at me darkly. He wagged his beard. He covered the slice of bread with a layer of chicken fat. I decided to take the risk. I said, where will you be? He sighed and breathed.
Ay. And ended the conversation. Judith, the night we met.
Genius Incorporated.
Gogo gave you my number.
And I said my name was Jody Mallon.
What happened after that?
I knew then and there that you were my soulmate.
And then?
After we left Genius Incorporated, we went and bought grapes.
And we?
We fed them to each other, and we rode the bus all night.
And when the night was over?
We began our work. The work we're still doing today.
Then it must be time for us to buy our grapes and begin.
Yes, it's time to begin.
Cindy. So we are recording it, that's why we're taking the mic, not that we can't speak loud enough. Sometimes audience members will say, people don't project how they used to do 40 years ago, and so sometimes it is actually not easy to hear, but first of all, thank you so much, and I think this is the Philip, you may remember, it's the first time this was read out, it was a collage put together for this evening, an experimental. Tell us a little bit about your idea for the play.
Yeah, I've been reading John Tytel's book about the Living Theater, which is called The Living Theater. And when I first bought it, Tom Walker said to me, oh, that's a great book, but it's very gossipy, which is very true and a lot of fun. I've read, at this point, I think most of what The Living has read, or written. And so now reading work about, not most of what they've read, most of what The Living has written. And so now reading what has been said about them is sort of an interesting experiment. And he talks about the way they met and just the circumstances of Judith lying and saying her name was Jody Malin because Judith Malina was a very ethnic name, and the getting the grapes and the taking the bus. And I just think it's a kind of beautiful story for something that no one would have known would become what it did. And so that was my entry point.
Thank you. So Philip is a dramaturgy student, right, at Columbia University, and a member for since many years? How many years?
About the 3 years at
three
this
years
point.
Now.
Yeah.
Cindy, how does that feel for you to listen to the play and to connect to the history?
Well, I'm very moved by what just happened in this space. Just to give a little backstory, Philip was my student. One of my greatest students ever, but he's very young.
Teach at
I'm a professor of drama at Hofstra University, and Philip was an honor student there, and created as part of his final thesis this extraordinary play that was based on diaries and documents of Judith's and Julian's, called The Life of the Theater. Mostly based on Judith's, Julian's text by that same name. So just to not talk forever about Phil's process, which he could do, I just want to say that he's been working with this material and on a very high level since he was a very, very young person. But it's kind of amazing to see how he's continuing to work. And in this context, I think it's just a beautiful piece of poetry which you created that's also extraordinarily performative and was beautifully embodied and voiced by these two people here. So one of the things I wanted to say is that it's moving, it's inspiring, and of course, as some of the words that you used, there's hope and there's tremendous energy in this piece that speaks to a very, I think, bright and exciting future. A living future, God willing, for the living. And I'm, you know, so that is one of the things I just wanted to put out there right away. But one thing I wanted to hear, I told Brad this earlier, I really am interested in hearing both from Brad and Monica about, well, they just took on, they embodied and voiced these extraordinary leaders, visionaries of perhaps a slightly other time, but now we're in this time. This is a very challenging time, as we all know. And this is a big question. But I'm wondering if you can think about or just try and articulate, and you too, Philip, what will be, and you too, Lois, what will be the work of the living going forward, where these inspirational, really brilliant figures, what they did is what they did, but where we're going, where you're going. I'd love to hear any way in which you can speak to that.
You don't want to say anything about Julian?
Me?
Embodying.
No, you go first.
Julian? Okay. I tried not to think about it so much leading up to today. I mean, Judith was my best pal in my 20s. So to be playing my best friend after she's dead is a sort of surreal moment. And I think in the way Monica and I were talking about it too, and playing them is, it wasn't so much like playing them, it was just reading their words as us and just remembering them every once in a while. Mm-hmm. You know, just remembering like Judith, okay. And you know, not doing my Judith impression, which my friends and family have heard me do many times.
I just want to say something, based on something that Dennis said to me a couple of minutes ago, you actually did a kind of an Anna Deavere Smith work where you just let the words become you, you know? You didn't take on Judith, but you let her work through you very beautifully, and you too with Julian, and that was kind of cool, you know, this gender fabulous swap thing, which then went to a Brechtian place, and I don't know what else. So I'm sorry, I have to
interrupt for a moment, Cindy and Brad and Monica and Philip and Frank, by way of saying that's who Judith was. Yeah, the comment that you made that we read her words and we, in a way, become her, certainly her spirit was reflected in I didn't know Julian Beck, but I will say Judith was present certainly in your play, in your comments, in your performance, and in you too, Monica, in your response to Judith. Just, you know, hi Judith, we're all here.
I think to talk to the future for a moment, I think the work of the company has always been the same. I think the name is a mission statement, and it's to respond to life and the people that are living in the company and whatever is important to us. You know, that's really what we do, and I don't think there's any reason for that to change. In watching the films all day, it's real, it's a labor to listen to these two people for hours and hours. And but I think that's the point. You know, I think that's really the point. The line in the play that Phil had, and actually Monica and Equiano came up with a song while we were on tour for, if we could feel the pain, then the pain would be so great that we would end it. And that's the point of the whole thing, is that if we could feel, like, that's why they don't stop and that's why we don't stop. We must feel this. We have to feel it or else we're not going to end it. And that's our work, I think. Our work is ending the pain for the living.
Speaking of political theater, also in the days where we are in and having watched so much of political theater also on the screens, but where is the work of the living going? I think Richard Schachner often, or sometimes said, the living has this great vision, which is so almost impossible to meet on stage. How can you? And even if you do it once in a while, how will you really be able to really have the same force as these inspirational, visionary ideas? So what are your plans? What are your projects you have in front of you, all of you as a company? I think there are others here could say, what do you think could the future look like? And what are you looking up to? What inspirations are you taking in?
Well, I think we're very privileged in that we're standing on Judith and Julian's shoulders already. So we have 70 years of work behind us, which is an advantage that they didn't have. And I think that that's incredibly important to right now. We're able to do a lot that they were not able to do at our ages, where they had to create avant-garde theater and create the alternative theater movement. We no longer have to do that. That's been done. And I think that is an advantage to us and what we're about to do now. And Monica can maybe speak a little bit to this. She's done more work with refugees than I have, but we're about to go on a winter tour to Western Europe to work with theater communities and refugee communities. That's what's up next for us.
You did a tour in the summer. Maybe tell a little bit to the audience what you did, what happened, and where you went. And
well, we drove to California and back. it was nuts. It was nuts. Actually, we have a couple of videos queued up if we want to see a couple of the two-minute street actions that happened.
Yeah, but maybe tell a little bit about the stations. And I don't recall that you had five, six, eight, some stops. You started in New York.
It was 20. We did 20 cities. And maybe even a little bit more. It was 3 weeks long. We spent 2 days in Chicago and 2 days in San Francisco, but otherwise it was like get up in the morning early, 5 to 10 hour drive, maybe some street theater at Boeing headquarters or something like that, and then arrive at a venue, warm up, perform, go to bed, wake up, repeat, you know, all the way across from Chicago, Detroit, Salt Lake City, Boulder, San Fran, down back through the south in Nevada. We went to El Paso and did an action at a border patrol station. We went to this experimental village, Arcosanti, in Arizona. Went to New Orleans, performed a street piece that two company members created called Black Body Radiation in Jackson Square in New Orleans. Birmingham, Alabama, Washington, D.C.
We primarily used, wow, this is on really strongly. It's so weird. We primarily used the, I don't know if some of you were here just before this, there was a screening of the play, Seven Meditations, that we did. Seven Meditations on Political Sadomasochism. And so we used that as a form and structure to, we were performing that in different places, and then we were also using those meditations, and if I explain, I'd rather have Philip explain it because he does it so well. But we used those seven meditations to do street performances as well. Not just street performances, actual interventions, actual direct action. And so really half of our time was either in the street and engaging with people. We also did workshops, or then, you know, taking that more into the cave of the subconscious and into the theater too. But I prefer being on the street more. And I think what's really powerful, especially about going and doing this tour, it's so raw. I mean, everyone's so heartbroken right now. And what Brad was saying about that, if we could feel, I think I see a lot of political theater that tries to be over above things or be very clever about things, and that's wonderful and great and has a place for it, as we need to be able to go and to intellectualize and think about where our place is in the world. But we also need to just break out of how we've been socialized and how obedient we are in this country. And we need to, you know, disrupt a little bit more and change things. And so I think that's what the living really does, is it demands you to feel. It demands your heart to be out on the slab, and that's what this tour was like.
And it also was a play from the living theater, like from the 70s in Brazil. You kind of like a DJ, as you kind of make a remix or an appropriation or a hybrid version of it. Maybe we could see a little. Is that the clips we have?
The clips we have are of the street performances.
Yeah, maybe we look at. We can look at.
Yeah, I mean, any one of them, Mike. You could do like. I think the one in Mormon Temple Square is pretty awesome.
Temple Square?
Yeah, in Salt Lake City. We can tell the little backstory behind that too.
Well, should we say it first or after? We should say
Over it.
Well, so the Mormon Church has this park, which was a public park before. It's right there at their center. But then they privatized it somehow, and they own it, and they can enforce their own laws there. And some of those laws are, for instance, couples of the same sex cannot be affectionate, cannot show affection within that park. And they have actually forcibly removed people for doing that. And just recently, they had a new rule come out in their book of rules of that children of same-sex couples can't join the church until they're 18, and then if they do choose to join, they have to denounce their parents. Mm-hmm. And so there was a mass exodus of people from the church at that point. This was just a couple months ago, I think. I mean, at the time when we did this, it was just a few months before this. And so we wanted to provide some solidarity, and we met with some people there who were ex-Mormons who had left the church, and they joined us in this. And we decided to show what love can be outside of the bounds of the church and outside of these faiths that constrict what love can be between people. So that's what it was.
And this was guerrilla performance? You just went there and
yes. Oh, yeah. This was illegal, actually. this is Yeah, and you don't see, but over on the side here, there's security guards yelling at us. Brad was being our liaison at the time, so he was dealing with that, running interference. Everybody was telling us to get out. There were children going by, like, "What's that, Daddy?" And the guy said, like, "Oh, I don't know what it is, but it certainly isn't for Jesus." And different things like that.
But also, didn't one dad have a good conversation?
Well, it wasn't that the dad had a good conversation exactly, but he said it's about LGBT, and the kid said, "What's that?" And that's all I heard of the conversation. But I think that even that moment alone has the potential to be a radical moment, because if that's not in that kid's vocabulary, if he hasn't heard LGBT before, which he very well may not have, it gives him a thing to Google. It gives him something to go home and look up, which I think is largely about what this was. And a lot of what we were doing was going out and saying, you need to be empowered to learn more. We're not here to tell you things. It is the sense of we're here to help you feel.
And you didn't see the moment before Philip's partner in this, John, who was a Mormon before, he was so terrified. We had a long talk with him afterwards. He was terrified to do this kind of thing, and because as soon as the security and the people came in from the church, he said that tone, that patriarchy coming in, he said he immediately froze, and he's like, "Oh, just kick us out. I don't want to have to do it. I don't want to do it." But with Philip's help, he did it, and then he felt changed by it, and that was one of them. We did many things like that at all sorts of mostly war machines. And
you want to see black body radiation from Washington, D.C.? Created by two company members, Equiano Mosieri.
Maybe Equiano wants to say,
you
something
say anything
about it first?
No, just watch it.
We'll just watch it. This is in Washington, D.C. This was created on the road, too. We did this while we were in the van.
Thank you. hill may rise.
Thank you. So it is somehow an idea, perhaps look almost like performance art intervention in public spaces, or redoing what Brecht once also told to his actors, you know, go to the street and pretend you have a fight, someone got shot, and see how you react, how the people react. His famous idea that, you know, a street scene, you just retell what happens and you put it into a mix. So this is an idea to create new theater and a legacy that you have with your company. So maybe we open it up to comments or questions. We have you here with us. So if you're a member or you have of the Living Theater, if you want to make a comment or if you have a question or an observation, let us know. Again, we thought it would be a right thing to have you guys here the day before the election. You know, I wonder what Judith Malina would have done, what she would have thought up to do. And where we are, and where this particular theater, which is now a great American tradition in a way, where it will be going.
It's really a classic question about theater. As I was listening to you all and very moved by your play, and I was in the Living Theater decades ago in Europe, I was thinking about, we're in an age of endless mediation. And way back in the 60s and 70s, when I was active in theater, there was this supercharged feeling about theater as a place of change and the physical presence, and the immediacy of another person. Now, we see atrocities on our televisions, phones, video, YouTube, Facebook, wherever. We're endlessly confronted by the pain and endlessly numbing ourselves. So I'm just sort of throwing out a comment or question about, is there something about the physical presence of the human being that goes beyond the mediation that can be part of theater and change and revolution and all that good stuff?
This is something I think about a lot. I was talking to a friend about this yesterday. I was saying, you know, heart surgeons don't walk around going, oh, but does heart surgery really save lives? They just know they do. But theater, I think we're constantly asking, you know, is there a real reason that we're doing this? One thing that we talked about on tour and that we talk about a lot is this, you can go through your day and never make eye contact with someone, or physical contact, or real contact. And that's part of what theater is. That's part of why doing it in the street, I think, is so radical and maybe even radical in a new way, in that, I mean, and I do this too. When I'm in line, I'm on my phone. And so you don't engage, I think, almost at all, unless you actively choose to. And to have someone who's really a stranger come up and just make 5 seconds of eye contact with you, that alone, I think, is revolutionary right now. And then to go from that into this idea of what do we do with our feelings? How do we activate them again? I think that's step one. Then we can figure out how to change the world, but first we have to actually know that we need to. And by know that we need to, really, I mean feel that we need to. And I think that that's why theater, and I think especially that's why street theater, for me at least. And yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to say, as a baby boomer, growing up in the 70s, I was particularly moved by this piece that you created, that you all created. I didn't go on the tour. I think it's one of the best pieces of the Living Theater I've seen, and I truly mean that. The thing that really affected me in watching it just now was the apathy of the people watching. I was waiting and waiting, and physically myself wanting to jump on that screen. So I think that's, you know, as Brad points out, nothing much has changed. That's our job as actors. But it's the audience's job, hopefully with our inspiration, to become a part of that. I also thought it was really poignant, I have to say, the baby wailing, you know. So everything old is new again. And that sounds perhaps pessimistic, but I mean it in a very optimistic way, because we're intergenerational, the company, and we teach each other. And you know, the Living Theater lives on. I know that didn't quite answer your question, but I wanted to share my feelings reflected on inspiring.
Hey, part of the answer to your question is really simple. If art wasn't necessary and culture wasn't necessary, then based on the science and the math that we have, we'd be converting to solar energy power right now without hesitation. So there is a massive amount of cognitive dissonance in the population, where we have clear information about all kinds of things. It's honestly, I mean, all of the street actions we did like 12 different street actions. We went into a bank to talk about eviction protocols. We were at Mormon Temple Square to talk about same-sex interracial religious issues, black body suffering. We have a Monsanto. There's a class song where we did in solidarity with prison complex, with the prison strike that's going on. We participated in the No DAPL protest in San Francisco all the way out there, and we've been performing in banks here for that. If math and science were enough, we would know. In 1851, the United States government signed a treaty with the Standing Rock Sioux Indians, and the case closed, and they don't want the pipeline built. So if facts were enough, then we wouldn't need art. So it's quite clear that we do need something that shakes up our soul and allows us to make progress. And for me, that's theater and performance, because of what Phil said, because of my experiences with everybody in the company. That's what has turned me on to these things.
And I'll add too that we get a great feedback towards us from it as well, which I remember when we did No Place to Hide at the Clemente Soto Velez, and then after we started doing it in the parks. And I remember afterwards, this man came up to a friend and I who were in the show, and he said, "I hate everything that you just said, and I want to tell you why." And I think that is part of what revolution starts as. Or even Leigh and I were at the RNC in Cleveland, and it was my first time meeting an honest-to-God, you know, loud, outspoken Trump supporter, which, did I change their mind? Probably not. They certainly didn't change mine. But now I don't picture that person as a demon. I know that that's a real person, and that affects my politics. And I think that the feedback for us as well is equally radical and exciting.
Play the devil's advocate.
Judith would say the devil has enough advocates. You can play an angel advocate.
Well, I love the Living Theater. I actually I published an essay about the Brig in a book of mine. I adored Living Theater, but when I hear you talk about feeling the pain and that will get us somewhere, as a reader of Dostoevsky and Freud, I wonder, don't we have to deal with, there's a dimension, a significant dimension of our human nature that likes the pain and likes to feel the pain and likes to administer the pain, and worse. And just feeling the pain isn't the magic. It can't be the magic in itself.
No, of course, there needs to be hope too. You have to be enlivened, you have to be activated by it. I mean, it's not just feeling the pain, it's feeling all the feels, right? It's everything. It's waking up. It's waking up to your own responsibility as a human being, to every other human being that we are responsible for on this planet. It's that. And so hopefully we begin to touch upon that in some small way. But of course, yeah, I mean, everyone's feeling pain. We could be, you know, so saturated and burnt out on it. It's not just that.
I mean, you're right. It's all complicated. It's so complicated.
But still, one could argue that the Living Theater does say, you know, after a time in perhaps Brecht's play, where you looked at a mother courage and she didn't learn anything, but you learned something and your mind changed, that companies like the Living Theater say, no, actually, that's not enough. Actually, you have to do something. You have to take action that socially engaged art, socially engaged theater right now has a tendency to say, you know, go out and do something. It's actually you who has to do something. And that's how I also see your work. Of course, you use emotion and pain, which perhaps a Brecht would have not agreed on. But I think this idea of a call to action, that actually it is up to someone up there to learn something and do something, is something that I think your work and many other companies who do political theater at the moment do think this is of significance, community-based, socially engaged art that really ask the participants to change their own lives and to intervene.
Yeah, I think that's the Artaudian balance to the Brechtian intellectualism. You know, the idea of saying, reducing it to if you can feel the pain, that stands a chance at being the arrow that pierces somebody in the audience's armor. Maybe that's the thought that gets them to pay attention to the rest of it. But of course, it's a whole gamut, and I think we try also sometimes, maybe not enough, to have joy in our work. The word beautiful is in our beautiful nonviolent anarchist revolution, so I think we try for that too.
Well, that.
Interesting. I asked Zizek at a conference, why was film and theater more interesting before the wall fell down? And we're on the cusp of an election. I wonder what your theater is going to look like if Trump gets in.
It'll be illegal.
Yeah, I don't know that. I don't know that. That's people have that that level of clarity about that fact. A lot of people that people love will be, their lives will be in serious jeopardy if he were to become elected. And a lot of people's lives will continue to be in jeopardy if he is not elected.
So what would you do as a refugee?
Well, we're going to help refugees in Europe next. And the way I feel about what we're doing right now with our work is, instead of rushing to make a play, we're listening to the world. We have this extreme luxury and privilege of this legacy, and it opens doors for us in many different places, and we get to work with many different generations of people everywhere we go. And I think we will learn what to do from the world when we go out into it, depending on whatever happens next. That's how I feel about it.
And I think part of what the tour did for us is helped us solidify this network that we know exists. And that we now have met and are friends with of radicals across the country who hold similar beliefs to ours and who are sympathetic to the cause, and people who I think in moments of extreme tension will be people who we can look to and converse with on what action is appropriate.
Sorry, is someone playing a baseball game or something? I can just hear the recording voice, it's in my
ear. Oh yeah, I do hear a recording somewhere.
Sorry, never mind.
Yes, I was struck watching the two instances of the street theater, which I was very glad to see, that they're clearly organized as artistic interventions, you might say. So it's not just about anger or pain or making a statement, but about constructing something that has flow and shape and so forth. Could you say something about the aesthetic? Do you think that you're developing, or are you sort of putting out a consistent aesthetic, or do you have that to the forefront of your mind as you're shaping you know, the intervention and the public appearance?
I also want to, there's other company members here too, so I want to make sure if any of you want to say something too.
Our people aren't shy, I don't think.
I just open it up.
I trust them. I trust them too. I'm much more interested in cultural movements than I am in artistic aesthetics at this point. I think that aesthetics are still very important, and the means of the message are also part of the message. But I only very recently, I was actually speaking with Professor Erica Fischer-Lichte, and she sort of made me feel less combative about aesthetics. I think that a lot of people get lost in aesthetics, and there's a lot of intellectual discourse on aesthetics, and it's really, to me, it's like, get some words and some movement, go to somewhere where something needs to change and fucking do something, to be quite honest. You know, like, I think there's so much over-intellectualization in the theater and performance community that that people actually theorize their way out of the fact that theater can be a means of social change, when for ever and ever before now, that's what it was. It was agitprop. There were hundreds of theaters and maybe even thousands in Russia, little local community theaters that did nothing but communicate from local people to other local people with like kind of like shoddy performers and not real experts, and that was the means of communicating about the real issues of life. And now people are so lost in breaking through. You know, Schechner has said recently that there is a lot of avant-garde work that is very good. There's a lot of people that know how to do it very well. There's a lot of people that have mastered the aesthetic and like are carving their own fine details into the etchings of the aesthetic, but there's very little new anything. There's very little groups pushing the boundaries of anything. And that's what, for me, when I don't know what the aesthetic is that can do that. I just know that we have words and we have bodies and we have to do something with them. And I'm hoping that the world will show us what the aesthetic is that we need, whether it involves technology or not, to break through to some kind of new level. Because it's quite clear that where we're at now is just collapsing all around us. So aesthetics, I mean, they're important, but for me it's more about cultural movements.
I'm pretty loud.
No, we're recording.
I just want to jump off that question. Before I studied, I didn't distinguish the word aesthetics from forms. And so still, I interpret that question as where do you draw your forms from? For example, because I've seen a lot of, I haven't seen a lot of living work, but I know that one of the distinct forms you guys work with is ritual circles and sound baths. So I guess I would add to that question by asking, because you are a new wave of the living, not just because you're young, where do you draw your forms from? Who do you reference in your work, consciously or not? And you may resent that question as well. But I know now that aesthetics carries a lot of weight academically, and it makes me furious in the same way. As a second part to that question, what are your forms? Where do you draw them from? How do you think your forms are useful?
Something that Judith says in the same letter that Lois read at a different part is, I follow anyone who makes the destination clear, but if no one does, then I will. Or I will, and this is now I'm going to start to paraphrase, but essentially I will get rid of everything that I know doesn't make the destination clear. I think that part of what we're doing is, as Brad is saying, listening for what it turns out is the way, which I think is what the living has always done. What's in our vocabulary right now includes biomechanics, includes a lot of what Joe Chaykin came up with, who was a company member and then went on to found The Open, includes Gnawa chants, a lot of ritual work, yes. And we still pull from that huge catalog, and this is part of our luck as a company and our incredible joy is that there are books that we can go to and say, oh, In 1970, they would have done this, and in 1980, they would have done this, and there are company members who are there for that, and it's this amazing thing. And so I think that we still use this beautiful extended catalog of movement and of sound and of technique and style, and a lot of what we do was developed by the Living Theater and now has gone on to become a thing for other people, which is really wonderful. And so I think we pull from that. And at the same time, we also pull from who the members are now and what their training is and where they come from, and then also look outwards towards what's happening and what we can use.
Let's take the mic, sorry.
That's right. I think something that's always been really fascinating about ritual or practice is that within ritual practice, the most important thing is repetition. And within repetition, you just naturally get a breaking out of form, which creates an organic aesthetic, whether you want it to or not. And so I think there were two questions that I'm trying to like mold into one. But with what we're gonna do now after tomorrow and where we're trying to go with the Living Theater, what I found working with these guys is that I came into something that had already, like a motion that had already been set. And what I tried to do was jump on this board and like stating myself and figure out, okay, where are these guys going with this? I was really just going off of blind faith. And then after sleeping on floors and drinking gas station coffee and starting off not enjoying it to starting off being very happy that we got to get just the cheapest coffee that was available, I found that we just let go of a lot of pretense. And we got to pop out of our bubble and we got to actually get to know each other. And we got to learn from each other and we got to let go of a lot of hang-ups that we had. And from all of that, I believe the aesthetic and the wanting to just burst through and just do something started to synthesize. And I think the more we continue to do that, because there's no way that we're gonna have the answer by Wednesday or even after we're done with the European trip, but the more that we continue to come together knowing what we're, like knowing a goal or some place that we're trying to reach, we're probably never gonna reach it, but we will definitely make headway. And the next time you see stuff that we've done in the street or performances that we've created, it will be a lot sharper, it will be a lot more powerful, and it will be a lot, and the ensemble will be just dynamic. And I think that's what the Living Theater was about. And I think that's why it's been going for 70 years, because not a lot of them are still doing this, but we're still doing this. And it's just continuing to keep the ball in the air and just continuing.
Yeah, I would say the Living Theater in 1947, when it was co-founded by Julian and Judith, looked backwards, inspired by what wasn't happening and what was happening as well, and found a way to take words and make sense out of them and found a new way to use the body. And I think from my perspective, having been in the company for some time now, there's a evolution going on, and I think things are changing, and that's very, very important for things to change. So to answer your question, instead of standing one way, we stand another. And in standing that other way, I'm being a little poetic here, not quite literal, we discover something new. And that's very exciting, and it gives birth to 5 or 10 or 1,000 other forms and ways to be.
Hi, I would also like to address upon the aesthetics and the form. Part of what was talking about before was actually communication, cultural movement. And I remember the time when I rehearsed with Judith and I read the books about how Living Theater was rehearsing. A lot of things actually coming out from how do we communicate with the audience? Is there other ways that we can engage with the audience members? From that point, we developed different aesthetics to engage the audience. On one of the shows that we did, Here We Are, we actually invite the audience members to create something, sandals actually, throughout the entire play, and then wear them, and then wear them back home on the street. That's the way that we engage, and we also demonstrate how the society could have been done better. And that's part of the form that we are still developing, that we are still experimenting the ways in which we can engage with the audience. And I think that's the aesthetics of the Living Theater.
Maybe one more comment. Yeah.
I would like to find out more about your work with the refugees that you're planning. And how you go about it. I mean, are you going with a plan? Are you going to develop your strategies on the go? How did you choose the place where you go? So I would just like to get a little bit of a picture of that.
Yeah. Excuse me. So we have a plan. And you're all coming with us. So we're working with some community groups out there. There's a few organizations that have centers that do free programming, cultural programming with refugees and with migrant communities in London, Berlin, Paris, Athens, and Oslo. And I spent a few months ago, I was working with refugees creating theater pieces in Vienna, I mean in Austria, in Kirchdorf, a small town, and also then working in Athens. And we're not going to necessarily be working with people that are, you know, just swam across the water and are in that state of emergency, but preferably more with people that have been settled for a little bit or are in a place where they're able to process a little bit more and be able to reflect on their journey and what's happened to them. And to create, we're doing workshops. We're doing theater workshops called, that's an old tradition of a living theater workshop called A Day in the Life of the City. And so we'll use that as a form to work with locals and also with refugee populations to work together, teach each other, share stories together, and then create small scenes from that together. And so it's about the issues and the things that concern them in this moment right now, and they get to talk about it. And it's really much more of an, it's not so much that we're going to go and save them and that we're going to help them. It's more that we're helping to facilitate conversations to happen, creation to happen, and sparks in you know, which can be very, very difficult situations where people who are brimming with hope and ideas and artistry and skills and sit on their hands because they're not allowed to work or they don't know where they're going to live or where they're going to be or where their family is. And so this is just going to be a small, tiny little peck, you know, through the darkness to bring some light to that.
I think we are close to our time. I will have a little reception here in the room, so I hope you will stay, ask questions, and comment, and say what was right or wrong, or what was missing. A last final question. Living theater never had a space owned by the living theater. I know as good anarchists, you couldn't really own something.
Not true.
That's good. Yeah. That's what I heard, and that this was one of the reasons. But will there be, are you looking for a space, or will it be outside? Will it be on the streets, or are you actually looking for a center for a home or a building?
I think that right now we're very content to be itinerant, and it allows us to go places and to learn from other people. Like Monica said, we're not trying to go save the world. I think we're actually trying to go learn what goes on, and without a rent and without big overhead expenses, we're able to do that. You know, we received a grant, we decided to do this with the grant. Whereas before, the black hole of real estate would have immediately taken almost all of that money immediate, like without hesitation. So in the future, perhaps, as we build towards it, or if it becomes a necessity, or if opportunity strikes. But I think right now, we're very content to find a home without, you know, and also within the people. I really think right now our home is the company itself. It's wherever we are together. That to me is the home of the living theater. It's sort of where it's always been, whether it's 3rd Street or 14th Street or 100th Street or Clinton Street.
Julian says at the end of Paradise Now, did not we take the audience to the doors of the theater and say, the theater is in the streets. It was then that we knew the streets were where we had to go. And I think that was true then and continues to be true for us now.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your legacy and also a year and a half after Judith's passing. And I know this is a big moment also in the camp in the history, but I think we all are very thrilled to see that, you know, you're listening, you're going out, and you're finding, reinterpreting, and there will be a long life,
hopefully the next 70 or 200 years there will be many, many more living theaters incarnations. And as Martha Graham once said, it's a great Martha Graham, sometimes I don't look for movements, movement come to me, and I think you're listening and something will also come to you. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you will have some questions for them here, and you will stay a bit for the reception. So thank you again, and thanks to the Living Theatre, and really congratulations to the company. That's not easy to work through these moments of change, and but it's also an opportunity. Thank you.
Thanks.